And then, of course, whether we need resistance form and other things like that. Okay, so sometimes if you cut off what's left of the tooth, then you have no tooth to get resistance, retention, and all the other things that we need. Retention and so on. Now, when we're looking at wear and occlusal disturbances, this is where it comes into long-term issues. So this patient came in for a broken tooth. Good to think about how much tooth structure. So this is actually a crown. I went through a stage of enthusiastic bonded crowns, you might say. Just one more little reminder, big jaw muscles. Okay, I can't emphasize enough. This has changed my practice. It hasn't changed it in any way in necessarily how I treat patients, but starting to look at the face and looking at people with big masseters, big square jaws, it means that I document in my notes that they have a high risk. Particularly if I see them, they look like this on the outside. On the inside, all their teeth are flat. All their canine guidance is gone. All their incisors are flat. Everything's flat, or chipped, or ground, or worn, or so on. So that's a patient where I record in the notes, this patient has a high risk of restoration fracture. So it's one of the diagnoses we make when we're doing the initial consultation, and then it's something we explain to the patient. Now, you don't need to explain to the patient that they will get to the lifespan of their crowns and then all of their crowns will just one day fall out, okay, which is what the patient thinks when you tell them that their teeth will wear out one day, that like they just all explode one day and that's it. You just say, look, if I do 10 over a 15-year period, you're probably going to replace a certain number. If over a 20-year period, you're probably going to replace them all. So letting the patient be realistic about that stops you from having to pay for dentistry. And they're not going to reduce their acceptance of treatment based on this. And if they say, well, if that's the case, I don't want to do it, is that bad or good? It's good, because when do you want the patient to tell you that they don't want to do the treatment? Before they do the treatment or after they do the treatment? Because I can tell you, when a patient says, I didn't want to do it after they had it done, it's very awkward for both of you. Okay, looking at teeth. If they destroy their natural teeth, they're going to destroy what you do for them. I'm seeing patients like this, I'm thinking monolithic Emacs, not Emacs with any sort of feldspathic porcelain layered on for making it pretty. It's not such an issue if it's single teeth, but as soon as you start getting into multiple teeth where the costs start to become much more significant, then the cost of maintenance is something you need to consider when you're talking about costs with patients. If your tissue is very thick, there's the root, there's no buccal bone there, there's just tissue attachment. If the tissue is really thick like this, you can cut that top piece off with your toothbrush and there's plenty of tissue left, it will grow back. But if your tissue is this thick and you cut that bit off with your toothbrush, it's gone. There you get recession. You can also cause inflammation with retraction cord. So if you have thin tissue like this and you place cord, then by the time the crown comes back from the lab, it's got recession. And it's a really important cosmetic case. So then you prep it again to the new margin, and it comes back from the lab, and you have more recession. When will the recession stop?